Hello everyone, this is Uday Kumar, Assistant Professor of Physics working in Dr. B.R.R. Government College, Jajjarla. So, today we are starting a new chapter which is varying and alternating currents. So, in this chapter, in today's video lesson, we are dealing the topic of the growth and decay of current in LR circuit. So this is the topic that we try to understand in today's video lesson, right?
Okay.
So coming to this one, so this is our topic, the growth and decay of current in an inductance resistance circuit, so which is called as LR circuit. So in our that means in our previous chapters we try to understand what is an inductor and what is a resistor. Okay, so here we are dealing the growth and decay of current in LR circuit. So this is what we are dealing. But before going on to the topic, let us just try to understand what is this varying and alternating current in short, right? So what is a varying current? So the current which is varying or the current which is not constant is called as varying current. So in this chapter we will be dealing the cases of the currents where either it will be growing or decaying and so on, right? So that is called as varying current. And alternating current is known to you already. So this is in short, we call it as AC current, so you know that. So alternating current is also the current whose magnitude will be continuously changing. Not only magnitude, even its polarity will be changing, right? So such a current is called as alternating current. Anyway, about this alternating current, we try to understand in detail when the topics whenever the topics that we come across during our video lessons. Okay, so now in today's video we are dealing the concept of varying current. So varying current is the one whose magnitude doesn't remain constant, rather it changes continuously with respect to time. So the first case of this varying current is this growth and decay of current. The first topic in the varying current is the growth and decay of current in an LR circuit. So this is the topic that we are going to deal. So anyway, what is an inductor, what is a resistor, you already know that. So the resistor is the one which opposes the current, right? Similarly, the inductor is also a device which opposes the EMF, right? So this we studied in electromagnetic induction. I hope you remember that one. Let us try to understand this circuit. So it is a circuit which consists inductor and resistor. It's a circuit which consists inductor and resistor and an EMF which is denoted by E. So it's a two-way key. It's a circuit which consists two-way key means here can you see this one, there is a switch S here and two terminals A and B are present here. So this we call it as a two-way key. That means either we can connect this switch S with A or with B. So depending on the situation we try to understand the varying current. That means if I connect S to A, what happens? This lower part of the circuits get closed and automatically because of this battery current starts flowing in the circuit. That means once the current starts flowing in the circuit, the current starts growing in this circuit. So if I connect S and A, it will be like I am studying the growth of the current in this circuit. Similarly, if I connect this S and B, what happens, it is like that means now I will be disconnecting the battery from the circuit of LR, and because of which the current start decaying, right? So depending on how you are connecting this S with the A or B, it will be like we are dealing the concept of the growth of current and decay of current. Okay, so anyway, so whatever I discussed, it's also written over here, so you can check it out. Let us take a circuit consisting a resistor whose resistance is R and an inductor whose inductance is L. Okay, so these two are connected in series. So a two-way key and a battery of EMF are connected in series as shown in the figure. Okay, so this is the figure which consists both L and R. Okay, so this is the circuit which consists both L and R. So now let us try to understand the growth of current. So what is the growth of current? So if I connect switch S to A, automatically the lower part of the circuit gets closed. Once the circuit is closed and we have a source here, we have a battery of EMF, right? And because of this battery, current starts flowing in this circuit. But remember, if there is no resistance at all, if there is no resistance at all, what happens? The current reaches its maximum value quickly, very quickly. But unfortunately, since we have a resistance and inductor in this circuit, the current will not reach its maximum value very quickly, rather it takes some time. Okay, so in how much time the current grows to how much of its initial or final value, all those things we study here. Okay, so that is what we try to understand here. So now let us just have a look at what is written over here. So when the switch S is connected to A, so this is switch S and this is A, right? Just know what I told you, the same thing is written over here, you can check it out. When switch S is connected to A, the current in the circuit grows from zero value, right? Is that fine? Because since it is open now, there will not be any current that is flowing in the upper part of the circuit. Once you connect S to A, initially when time t is equal to 0, you know that the current that is flowing in the circuit will be 0, right? So once the time starts increasing, that means after 0, the current value in this lower part of the circuit starts increasing. So that is written over here. Okay, so now the circuit and the current in the circuit grows from zero value. When current is flowing in the circuit, the inductance L opposes the growth of current due to back EMF. This is what I told you. So an inductor is the one you already studied, that one, back EMF, induced EMF, all these terms you already we already studied in electromagnetic induction. So here, when the current is flowing inside the circuit, the inductance L opposes the growth of current due to back EMF. Is that clear? So initially in this circuit, you know that the current that is flowing in this is zero. Once the current starts growing, it is changing. This is what Faraday found, right? Whenever the flux linked with the coil changes, an EMF is induced. And from Lenz's law, we already studied that EMF will be opposite to the original cause that it produces. All those things we studied in electromagnetic induction, right? The same concept comes here also. Once the current that is flowing in the circuit starts increasing, an EMF is induced across this inductor, which opposes the original EMF because of which the current is produced. Remember, the current in this circuit is due to this EMF, right? Okay, and if the current is constant in this circuit, there is no problem. But initially at time t is equal to 0, the current is increasing. Initially at time t is equal to 0, the current is 0. And as time increases, the current increases. Since the current is increasing here, which is changing, an EMF is induced across L, which opposes the growth of the current, which opposes the increasing nature of the current. So that is what you have to know. This is the function of inductor. Okay, an inductor is a device which opposes the change. In simple words, if the current is increasing, it tries to decrease it. If the current is decreasing, it tries to increase it. That's it. Okay, fine. And that means a back EMF is induced in such a way that it opposes the original cause that produces it, and that back EMF induced is given by minus L into di by dt. So you know this formula, we have studied this formula again in the chapter of electromagnetic induction. Okay, So fine, I hope it is clear. So let at any time t the current that is flowing through this circuit is I, and back EMF induced across L is given by minus L into di by dt. So that means you know that when time t is equal to 0, the current when switch S is connected to A, this is the case that we are studying. Remember, when S is connected to A, the lower circuit is closed now. Since the lower circuit is closed, the current starts flowing in this lower circuit from positive terminal of battery to negative terminal of battery. You know this one, right? So initially at time t is equal to 0, this current will be 0. You can take this I by small I or capital I. Since in the equation I have taken it as small I, let me take it as small I. Here also you have to write it as small I. So at time t is equal to 0, you know that I is equal to 0, but as time increases, the current also increases. Since the current is increasing, an EMF is induced across L, which is given by minus L into di by dt. Okay, so where I is the current in this circuit at a particular instant of time t. Okay, let us say that when time t is equal to t, if the current that is flowing in the circuit is I, right, then the induced EMF, which we call it as back EMF, right, the back EMF that is created inside the circuit across this inductor is given by induced EMF, which is equal to minus L into di by dt. So this is applied EMF, capital E is the applied EMF, because of which the current is increasing in the circuit, and this induced EMF is minus L into di by dt, which is opposing the increasing current in the circuit. Okay, so now in overall we have two EMFs, one is applied EMF, another one is induced EMF. So one EMF we are applying, but another EMF is created inside the circuit because of the changing current that we are not applying. Okay, so now by using Ohm's law, I can write an equation here like this. For example, so for convenience, let me just take a circuit for your convenience. Let us assume that I am applying an EMF E to this circuit whose resistance is given by R. So if the current that is flowing in this circuit is I, what do I write? I write it as EMF is equal to I times capital R by using Ohm's law. So we write this equation by using Ohm's law, right? I hope you remember this formula. The same Ohm's law is used here also, but unfortunately here we just don't have one resistor, we have inductor also. Okay, so because of this, the total EMF that is present in the lower part of the circuit becomes, this is applied EMF. Okay, this is applied. This equation is right now written by using Ohm's law. This is applied EMF because of which the current is flowing, but this induced EMF is opposing the original EMF, right? Since it is opposing, I write it as minus L di by dt, which is equal to, now the current at a particular instant of time t, the current that is flowing is I, right? And because of that, I becomes I, and the resistance in the circuit is capital. So for this circuit, the equation of EMF in terms of current is given by this equation. So if we have only resistance, R, the equation would be like E is equal to I times R. Okay, but since in this equation we have two EMFs, one is applied EMF, another one is induced EMF. Remember, induced EMF is not applied by us, but it is being created within the circuit because of the changing current, and that induced EMF is always opposing. It will be always opposing the original EMF, because of which the current is increasing, right? And that opposing nature is mentioned with minus here. So that is what you have to understand. Even if you you are confused, let us take one more example. Okay, where is the arrow? Okay, so let us take one more example. So for example, let us assume that this is resistance R, and if I take this as E1, and let us take one more EMF. This is plus, this is also plus, this as E2, and that means if I take two EMFs, or suppose if I take two EMFs in the circuit in which consists a resistance R. Now, because of these two EMFs, some current flows in this circuit, right? That current, if I take this as I, you already know Kirchhoff's voltage law, Kirchhoff's current law, also you know that, right? How to take the EMFs, positive, negatives, you must be knowing here. In this case, what happens, both E1 and E2, they are along the same direction, let us say. That means, if the positive terminal of E1 is on left hand side, the positive terminal of E2 is also on left hand side, right? That means, due to these two EMFs, the current will be flowing in the same direction in the circuit, and because of this, both the EMFs are taken positive. So, if I take, that means if I try to write the equation by using Ohm's law, what I write here, I can write it as E1 plus E2 is equal to I times capital R. So, this is the equation that I get, where E1 plus E2 is the total EMF that is present inside the circuit. Okay, so if I apply two voltages or two EMFs, the equation that we write by using Ohm's law will be like this, right? If I apply two EMFs, but here in this case we are not applying two EMFs, but this will be like the case of applying two EMFs. It will be like, that's what I am saying. Okay, we have two EMFs now. One is applied EMF that we are applying, and another one is induced EMF. This induced EMF is not applied by us, but this induced EMF is opposing the applied EMF. Okay, if remember, if they are supporting each other, we get E1 plus E2, which we call it as total EMF. Total EMF in this circuit. For example, if the polarity of E2 is reversed, here it becomes E1 minus E2. The same thing happens here also. The applied EMF is capital E, and the induced EMF is minus L di by dt. Okay, since the nature of this induced EMF is opposing the applied EMF, the total EMF will be capital E minus this epsilon. Okay, so capital E minus this epsilon, what happens, I write it as E minus L di by dt. So the total EMF of this circuit becomes E minus L di by dt is equal to IR. Remember, this is the physics part. So that means by using physics, the concept of total EMF, we are just writing the equation. Once you understand this part, the remaining thing will be completely mathematical. Okay, so mathematical part we are going to do from here on. Okay, so by using Ohm's law to the lower circuit that we are considering to understand the growth of current, what is the equation that I get? I get it as E minus L di by dt is equal to I into capital R, where E is applied EMF, and minus L into di by dt is the induced EMF that is created across inductor because of the change in current. I hope it is clear. This is the physics part. Now coming to the derivation part, by using Ohm's law, I can write this equation as E minus L di by dt, which is equal to I into capital R. You know this one. So by rearranging, let us take this equation as one, and by rearranging the terms, what I get, so take this IR to left hand side and this minus L di by dt to right hand side. If I do so, I get E minus I into R is equal to L di by dt, and on rearranging the terms, that means I terms are brought to one side and the dt terms are brought to another side. If I do so, what I get, on rearranging, by cross multiplication also you can do. So take this dt to left hand side and L to left hand side, what I get, let me take the marker now. So this equation I can write it as, so if I take dt to left hand side, what I get, I get dt, and if I take L to left hand side, I get L. So dt by L is equal to, I can write this equation as di by, so this E minus I into capital R is taken to right hand side. If I do so, this is the equation that I get, E minus R I into R. So whatever it is, so this equation we can write like this also, right? So the left hand side terms can be kept on right hand side, and RHS can be kept on left hand side because they are equal. Okay, so if I rearrange the terms, I get this equation. So dI by P minus RI will be equal to dt by R. So this is the equation that I get. So if I integrate this equation, what I get? So if I integrate, apply the integration on both sides. So if I integrate this equation, I get this formula. You must be knowing this formula, integral 1 by x is log x, right? Okay. So that formula, if I apply here, so integral dI by this e minus r I is in denominator, right? So and hence it is like integral dx by x, integral dx by x. So applying this formula, what I get? I get it as log x, right? So if you apply that formula, so for example, let me write this equation. You know that this formula, you know this formula, right? Integral dx by x is log x. Okay, but here in this case, x is not just x, it is e minus ri. Okay, so if you apply this formula here, so in place of x, what I get? So log x. So in place of x, we have a log to the base e minus ri. And this x is not just x, rather it is the that means it's a function which consists some constants also. E and r are the constants here. So since it is not just x, rather the function of x, it's a function of x, right? And because of that, you have to differentiate this function of I and keep whatever the value that you get in denominator. You know these formulas, right? And these are integral formulas. If it is just x, you get this equation. But since x is the function of I, okay, it's a function of I which consists that means induced EMF, sorry, applied EMF E and the resistance R. Differentiate this equation. If I differentiate this equation, d by di of E minus Ri. What do I get? Since this applied EMF is constant, this becomes 0, and d by di of minus ri becomes minus r. So this is the equation that I get. And whatever the value that you get when you differentiate this function of I, that has to be kept in the denominator of this formula. Okay, so these are the formulas. I hope you know this one. Okay, so remember, integral dx by x is log x. So first you use that formula. Once you apply that formula, again you have to differentiate it, this function which is kept inside the line. And if you differentiate that function, you get minus r, and that has to be kept in the denominator of this log e minus r. If I do so, this is the equation that I get. And similarly, integral dt by L, since L is constant, 1 by L is taken out, and integral dt by integral dt becomes t. And let us take the constant of integration as capital A. So I am erasing everything now. So if I integrate this equation, this is the formula that I get. Let us take this equation as 2 now. But you know that at time t is equal to 0, the current that is flowing in an equation is 0. Okay. So you know that, right? We already have seen it. Okay, once you connect this switch S to A, at time t is equal to 0, the current that is flowing in this circuit will be 0. So that condition, these are called as in simple words, you can say that these are boundary conditions, right? When time t is equal to 0, the current that is I in this circuit will be 0. So that condition is applied in equation 2. If you apply that equation, what happens? You can find the constant of integration. Okay, once you find the constant of integration, substitute it in equation 2 automatically on rearranging and simple, that means by doing simple calculation, you get an equation of current which becomes the current equation for the case of growth of current. Okay, that is what we are going to do. Okay. So substituting above condition equation 2, what is the condition? This one, at time t is equal to 0, I is equal to 0. If I substitute in this equation, what I get? At time t is equal to 0, this is 0, right? So that means this entire part will be 0. and again I is equal to 0 when t is equal to 0, right? So when time t is equal to 0, this I is also 0. So that means this ri also becomes 0. So once you substitute, what you get, you just check it out. So log to the base e is written as it is. Okay, log to the base e is written as it is. And what do I have? We have e minus ri. So e minus ri in place of ri, I is equal to 0, right? And hence this entire part becomes 0. Okay, divided by, what do I have here? We have minus r. So write it as it is. And on right hand side, we have t. So you know that this is the condition. Time t is equal to 0, I is 0. That is what we are doing. So when time t is equal to 0, this t by l also becomes 0. Okay? And this a constant of integration is written as it is. So this is 0 and this is also 0. And from this, I get the formula of a. So what is a? A becomes minus, this is minus, minus 1 by r log to the base e capital A. So let us take this equation as 3. So now this is the formula of constant of integration. So substitute this 3 in 2. So this is 2. So in place of A, you have to substitute this 2. So if I substitute, what do I get? So this is what? This is, we have minus in equation 2, right? And because of that, if I write that minus outside, minus 1 by r, this is what I get. Minus log capital E minus r by r. This is the equation that I get. Minus log capital E minus r by r, and that r is written outside. Okay, that means we are separating the terms. That is equal to, on right hand side we have t by l, so write it as it is. And we have a now, but a is found to be how much? This one, minus 1 by r log e. So substitute that equation 3 into, if I do so, this is the equation that I get. So now we have to simplify, that's it. We have to simplify and find the equation of I from this one. So if I do so, what I get? Let us check. So let me take the marker now. So you can multiply with minus on both sides of this equation, right? If I do so, what I get? If I multiply minus with both sides, I get 1 by r log e minus ri on left hand side, and this will be equal to t by l. This becomes minus, and minus of minus becomes plus, and this becomes 1 by r log t. So if I multiply with minus to this equation on both sides, we are going to get this equation. Okay, so this is the equation I get. So if I multiply with capital R again on both sides, what do I get? If I multiply this entire equation with capital R on both sides, I get capital R here, I get capital R here, I get capital R here. So that means this R get cancelled, this R also get cancelled. So what will be left? On left hand side, we have only log E minus Ri. Can you see this one? We have only log e minus ri, and on right hand side we have minus t capital R by l. Okay, can you see this one? This is minus t capital R by l, and this becomes log e. So this is the equation that I get. I hope it is clear. And the next one, now we have to just rearrange the terms. So if I take this log of capital E to the left hand side, I get this as log e minus ri. It is written as it is. And this is taken to the left hand side. If I take it to the left hand side, it becomes minus. And on right hand side, we will have minus capital R by L into 2. So, but you know that log m minus log n is log m by n. This is the formula in logarithms. Log m minus log n is written as log m by n. So this is one formula that we use in logarithms. So we have log e minus ri, which is taken as m, and log e, which is taken as m. That means e minus ri is taken as m and e is taken as n. So if I apply this formula here, so we get log m minus log n becomes log n by n. So that means we get this e minus ri is taken as m and this e is taken as n. So log m minus log n becomes log m by n, where m is e minus ri and n is e. will be equal to, and on right hand side we have minus R minus capital R by L into T. So this is the equation that I get. So if I apply exponential on both sides, or in other words, you can say that if I send this logarithm to the right hand side, it becomes exponential, right? In simple words, you can say that applying exponential on both sides, and exponential and logarithms, they do get cancelled, and hence on left hand side we get E minus RA by capital E will be equal to, and on right hand side I get exponential of minus capital R by L into T. So if I split these terms, what I get, I can write this equation as E by capital E minus R into I by capital E. So this E and E gets cancelled, right? So this E and E gets cancelled, and hence it becomes 1. So this equation I can write it as 1 minus capital R by E times I is equal to exponential minus capital R by L into T. So this is the equation that I get. Okay, so on rearranging the terms, that means if I send this capital R by I into I, which is minus, to right hand side, and this part to the left hand side, what do I get? I get this equation, right? Do I? So if I send, and that means I can write this equation as 1 minus of exponential minus R by L into T. So that means this is sent to left hand side, and the other term, what is the other term? This one, minus R E by I, is sent to right hand side. So if I do so, I get capital R V by E times I. So that means this minus becomes plus when it goes to the right hand side. So this is the equation that I get. So if I just rearrange the terms, that means LHS, if it is written as RHS, so this is LHS, right? If it is written as RHS, this is the term that I get. 1 minus exponential minus capital R by L into T. And this right hand side value, if I write it on LHS, what do I get? I get R by E times I. I can write in that way, right? Because they are equal, right? Okay? So this is the equation that I get. So if now, if this R by E is sent to right hand side, what I get? I get this as I is equal to capital E by capital R in brackets, so it becomes 1 minus exponential minus capital R by L into T. So this is the equation that I get when this switch S is connected to A. So that means at a particular instant of time, T, the current that is flowing in this lower part of the circuit, is taken as I, right? That I, in terms of a formula with respect to time, is found to be this equation, okay, where this E by R, if I denote it as I0, which is called as the maximum current, okay, I0 is called as maximum current, right? I hope you understood this, because please check it out, okay. This L opposes the growth of current, right? If there is no L at all, what happens? The current that is flowing in the circuit will be maximum, right? If there is no L, the current that is flowing in the circuit will be maximum. If there is no L, what happens? The circuit will be like this. Only EMF E and capital R. And in this case, I can write this E as I into capital R. And where in this case, I will be maximum. When L is not there, the current will be maximum. So please remember this one. When L is not there, the current is maximum. Will be maximum. And that maximum current, in terms of mathematical equation, I can write it as capital E by capital R. Because if L is not there, what happens? I is written as capital E by capital R, right? If L is not there. And that I will be maximum when L is not there. So that maximum current can be written here from this equation. So I can write it as E by R when L is not there. And that maximum current, if I denote it with I naught, what I get? This equation I can write it as, where this E by R is the maximum current. Okay, so this current will be maximum when L is not there. So please check it out, when L is not there. So even if it is there, its action should be like absent from the circuit itself. That means even if it is there, we cannot treat it. okay, like that. Okay, so if I take this E by R as maximum, which is I0, maximum current in the circuit, then this equation I can write it as I is equal to I0 times in bracket 1 minus exponential minus R by L into T. So this is the equation that I get. So this is the formula of current, formula for the current that is flowing in the circuit, in the lower part of the circuit that we have considered at a particular instant of time, which is T. So this is I, which is a function of T now. So when time t is equal to 0, we already know that we have used the condition, right? When time t is equal to 0, I must be 0, right? So whether we are getting this I is equal to 0 from this equation, that we can check here. So if you want to check, you can check. At time t is equal to 0, I can write it as I0 in brackets 1 minus exponential. When time t is equal to 0, what happens? This bracket part becomes 0. So that exponential of this becomes 0, right? So if I substitute that 0 here, this becomes I0 times in bracket 1 we have as it is, but we know that exponential 0 is 0, sorry, exponential 0 is 1. Since it is 1, we get 1 minus 1 inside the bracket, and 1 minus 1 becomes 0. So that means at time t is equal to 0, the current I must be 0, and that condition has to be satisfied with this mathematical expression when we apply that condition. So, is that condition is satisfying or not, we can check it here, okay? Similarly, if I substitute when time t is equal to infinity, the current value will be how much, that we just check it out. At time t is equal to infinity, I can write this equation as I, which is equal to I0 in bracket 1 minus exponential. When time t is equal to infinity, it becomes infinity. So, exponential of minus infinity, I can write it as 1 by exponential of infinity. So since exponential of infinity is in denominator, it acts like infinity in denominator, and you know that 1 by infinity is 0, and substituting that we get 1 minus 0 here, and similarly since 0 is negligible, I0 into 1 I can write it as I0. That means I becomes I0 at time t is equal to infinity. So what does that mean? It means that when time t is equal to 0, I is 0 in the circuit. And when time t is equal to infinity, the current reaches to its maximum value. So that conditions I can graphically represent it with this graph. So here I is taken along y axis and time is taken along x axis. So when time t is equal to 0, the current will be 0. So that point is mentioned here. So this is the mathematical expression of current in the circuit when switch S is connected to A. Right, that is what we are studying. So here from this equation it is clear that at time t is equal to 0, current is 0. As time increases, the current is increasing, and the increasing nature of the current is denoted with this curve. So this is called as the growth of current curve, the curve which shows the growth of current. And remember, this is exponential 1 minus exponential, that nature is represented with this curve. Okay, so at time t is equal to 0, current is 0, and similarly at time t is equal to infinity, remember this is a time which is taken along x axis, right? At time t is equal to infinity, the current reaches its maximum value. So at time t is equal to infinity, the current reaches its maximum value. It means that the current never reaches its maximum value. Even if it reaches, it takes a lot of time. Which is like infinity for the system. Okay. Okay, that's it. So this is this is the graphical representation of the current equation that we got for the concept of growth of current. Okay. So anyway, in this case, that means from this equation, this is the equation that we got for growth of current, right? That expression we can write here, I is equal to I0 times 1 minus exponential minus R by L into T. Here we get a concept of a time constant here. What is time constant that we try to understand this slide. So the equation 4 is also written as like this, so you already know in this slide we already studied. So this is the equation that I get. So the same equation I can write it as I0 times 1 minus exponential. If I take tau is equal to L by, we have R by L here, right? So if this R is taken to denominator, we get L by R inside the denominator. And if I take that L by R with tau, if I just take capital L by R with tau, if I denote capital L by R with tau, this equation I can write it as I0 written as it is in brackets 1 minus exponential, minus is written as it is, and we have small t in numerator, and in denominator we will be having L by R, and if I take that L by R with tau, the equation I can write it like this, you can write it like this. So what is time constant? This time constant is nothing but L by R. This time constant is nothing but L by R. That time constant we can try to understand here. Okay, what is that time? Okay, anyway, so when time t is equal to L by R, okay, when time t is equal to L by R, what happens if I substitute when time t is equal to L by R in this equation? Okay, so what happens? Let us check it. So I can write this current equation I is equal to I0 in brackets 1 minus exponential minus R by L into t. But when time t is equal to L by R, t is equal to L by R, this L by R and R by L, they get cancelled, right? If they get cancelled, we get 1 here, minus 1 in this bracket. So substitute that. If I do so, I get I0 in brackets 1 minus exponential minus 1. This equation I can write it as I0 in brackets 1 minus exponential minus 1, I can write it as 1 by E. But E is equal to 2.718. Substitute that equation in this one. So if I just simplify it, I can write this equation as I0 in brackets E minus 1 by E. But E is 2.718. Substitute that. If I substitute that, we get 2.718 minus 1 by 2.718. This numerator will be having a value of 1.718 by, and denominator will be 2.718, and this value becomes 0.63 times I0. So this 0.63 I can write it as 63 by 100, right? So 63 by 100 can be written as 63% of, and we have I0 here, so write that this I0 as it is. So we have an equation here, I is equal to 63% of I0. But in our previous slides we know that I0 is nothing but the maximum value of current that can be flown in the circuit, and I is the current that is flowing in the circuit when time t is equal to L by R, when time t is equal to L by R. Okay, so now this time constant is defined as the time in which the current flows, the current that is flowing in the circuit will be equal to 63% of the maximum current that can be flown in the circuit. So this is the definition of a time constant. So I just have given a definition here. If you want to write, you can write in this way also. The time constant is defined as the time in which the current rises from 0 to 63% of its final value. What is its final value? Final value is nothing but the maximum value of the current that is flowing in the circuit. So this is the definition of time constant. Okay. So this time constant also can be asked in your board examinations for short answer questions. So you must be familiar with this one. So anyway, remember this is the current equation of current that we get for the case of the growth of current. Time t is equal to 0, the current will be 0, and as time increases, the current also increases. And the maximum value of current that can be flown in the circuit is I0. When time t is equal to L by R, that means the current that is flowing in the circuit, I can write it as 63% of I0. From this equation, we define this time constant. Okay, so this time constant is nothing but tau, which is denoted by L by R. So I hope it is clear. Because of time factor, we will stop here. In our next video, we will try to continue this topic. This topic is not finished. This topic is really a very lengthy topic. We are still doing the growth of current. We are trying to study the growth of current, right? Anyway, we have done the derivation part. In our next video, we try to understand the behavior of inductor in terms of growth of current, and also we try to understand the decay of current in LR circuit. So this is what we do in our next video. I will stop here now. We will meet in our next video. Thank you.